saw us recording. After about 27 minutes, you need to come up here and hit twice again. So it starts recording again in the new file. So hit it, just hit it twice. And make sure you get it red.
All right, so now y'all know four words that Sheila can't stand, right? I told you so. So make sure you tell that to her later. All right, Sheila, how's that? She's not playing. All right, well, today we're going to bring our series examining Paul's last letter to completion by turning into 2 Timothy chapter 4. And we're going to read together verses 1 through 8. Again, that is 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 8, as we bring our entire series examining this last letter from Paul as he is writing from prison. We bring it to completion looking at this text here today. If you're opening your Bible to 2 Timothy, you're going to notice there's more than 8 verses in that particular chapter. In fact, there's 22. So you may be wondering why we'll be stopping at verse 8 and maybe not going on further. And part of that is because what's written after verse 8 is really specific instructions given primarily to Timothy. It's not really something that maybe we can necessarily apply to our lives, as Paul is wrapping up his letter at that particular moment, takes an opportunity to give some personal instructions to Timothy. He desires for Timothy to see him in prison. So in verses 9 through 18, he gives Timothy some personal instructions and some things of that nature. And in the very finale, in verses 19 through 22, he bids farewell and does a final greeting and benediction. So we're going to read through verse 8. So we're going to see in that text today that there is a specific charge given to Timothy. And we're going to apply it to our lives, understanding that it's not just a directive or a charge given to Timothy, specifically and exclusively only to him, but one that we can also apply to our lives and should carry out as well. So with all that, we have a question to entertain this morning before we get to the reading. And the question is this: what do you do when you are instructed and commanded or directed to do a specific task, given some instructions? What do you do? Do you do it as given, as commanded, and do it and carry it out? Or do you sometimes procrastinate and maybe do it at your own leisure, in your own way, in your own timing? Or even sometimes when someone gives you a command, a directive, a charge, whether it's one like we're going to see today in Timothy or a different kind of charge, do you just stop, whine, and cry about it? Like, you know, when you have your kids younger, I mean, like my children when they were younger, I mean, they're older now and away from the house, but yeah, I remember those days whenever they were living at our house and we say, Kayla, I want you to take out the trash. Say, but Daddy, I don't want to take out the trash. I mean, they'd whine and cry about it, right? Or if I say, Chase, it's time to clean your room. And he says, Dad, I don't want to clean my room. I mean, that's what they do. As children, sometimes they whine and cry about certain things, but don't we also sometimes do that as adults? Whine and cry, or at least do things in our own way, or just simply completely ignore whatever it is that we should be doing. Now, Sheila this morning was listening to some of my notes, and she gave me an I told you so to me. I mean, she said, you know, a perfect example of what you're talking about is how you, Curt, how you react. When you're going down the highway and all of a sudden you come up on some rope instruction and it's been posted to slow down and you start to slow down for the rope instruction as you're supposed to. I mean, there's always a posted speed limit to slow down to when you come up on the rope instruction. If you're on I-69, you can't go 70 through the rope instruction. You got to slow down. And sometimes they'll say 45 miles per hour through the rope instruction, and you have to really obey because, you know, if you get caught speeding, it's twice the amount of the fine and so forth. So anyway, we come up on the rope instruction quite often when we're driving, as people just do naturally. But what aggravates me that I cannot stand and I begin to whine and cry about is when nobody is there working. You ever have that happen?
Yeah.
I mean, they have miles of these barrels and they go on and on. on and on. But where are the people supposed to be working? I mean, I'm thinking, why do I need to be slowing down when there's nobody here? I mean, if you're going to do some road construction, do the segment you're going to do and have people to slow down there. I don't need 6 miles of barrels, right? You know what I'm talking about?
Amen.
So yeah, I probably have obeyed somewhat, but then the obedience of the posted speed limit, I admittedly probably whined and cried about it. Because what we do sometimes when we're asked to obey or asked to do something as requested, sometimes we either do it in our own way or we whine and cry. And speaking of doing things in our own way, I love the show Home Improvement. I mean, I've been watching Home Improvement for the years that it was on, and maybe I can relate to Home Improvement because, you know, I shared with you last Sunday how my dad and I would sometimes do these weekend work projects in carpentry. We would go to somebody's house and, you know, build some bookshelves or remodel kitchen and stuff like that. And so I had a way of relating to Tim, the tool man Taylor, because I had that kind of experience of doing stuff with dad as a child growing up, doing some woodworking. So in the show Home Improvement, if you've ever seen it, you know that Tim is always determined to make something better. It seems to be working, but he is determined he can make it better, more powerful, or whatever. So there's one particular episode I remember where the dishwasher is effectively working, okay? And as the dishwasher is effectively working, washing dishes just like it's supposed to, he is determined he can make the dishwasher better. Again, remember, it is working perfectly fine, but he tells his wife, Jill, he says, Jill, I'm going to mess with the dishwasher. I'm going to make it so powerful, the dishes will be done in less than half the time. Which maybe sounds like a good thing. But Jill knows Tim's past and knows that everything Tim touches normally does not get any better. What happens? They get worse. And so she gives Tim a directive, a specific charge, a command saying, Tim, do not touch the dishwasher. Leave it alone. And she has to reiterate that more than once. Because we're men, we have to hear things more than once. And then we still don't do it. Because when Jill gets a phone call in this particular episode, it happens to be where she is wanting to have an interview for a new job. They call her and tell her to come in a certain time, so she gets ready to leave the house. What does she do before she leaves the house? She goes right back to Tim one more time. And she says, Tim, leave the dishwasher alone. It works fine. I like it as it is. But does Tim follow the command? Does he follow the directive? No, of course not. As soon as her heels hit the sidewalk outside to the car, he is tinkering with the dishwasher. He fixes it up the best way he can. And of course, what happens? It blows up. That's what we do, it seems at times. When we're given a specific directive or command or charge, we sometimes do not leave it alone. We sometimes do it at our leisure, if we do it at all, or we make certain changes in the way we want it to be done. Now listen, we might get by with that in civilian life, but in the military, that don't cut it, does it? There's no one I know that has survived the military by changing a directive, a charge, or command. They follow the order as given, or they aren't there anymore. But in our way, sometimes we do it in the way we want it done. So it begs a new question for us then. As we narrow the question into something we want to talk about today, the question really becomes, do we obey or disobey? When a command comes as written in the scriptures, as we're going to find one today that Paul is writing to Timothy, do we obey it? Do we follow it as a directive? Or do we disobey? I mean, here we are now coming to the finale of a series we've been in for several weeks, in fact, months. And Paul has been very direct with Timothy upon multiple occasions in this letter that we have been examining. I mean, he has instructed Timothy many times about a specific task. He has told Timothy to persevere, to endure the persecution, to keep the faith. And he's given them directives throughout. But nothing like we see today. It is Paul's final directive, a charge given to Timothy. And remember, it's not just to Timothy in which we can apply, but yet to all of us. And Paul fully expects Timothy to keep the charge as given. Again, it's found in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Stand with me if you're able to, as we do read verses 1 through 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. Again, Paul, writing to Timothy, his last and final words, he tells Timothy, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge, the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Well, Father, Lord, we do come again before you this morning, having read your word, as we do each Sunday, Lord, and ask now for a blessing to be upon it. And Lord, today we want to turn our attention to the finale of this letter that we have been dissecting for many, many weeks. And Lord, we pray today that your Spirit will lead and guide and give us the wisdom and directive and the words we need to hear today. And Lord, let us be bold enough, not just to hear it, but to be able to put it into practice, into life. So Lord, again, lead and guide and direct us here this morning. And let us be extremely grateful for what's happened here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, while the text we're looking at here in 2 Timothy chapter 4, at least the part that we're examining, is only 8 verses in length, scholars typically divide these 8 verses into 2 different segments or units. They take the first portion in verses 1 through 5, and they say, this is the charge given from Paul to Timothy. And then they look at the rest of it into a different section in verses 6 through 8 and says, here is the crown given to Paul, but to other believers as well. And so today, we don't have time to go through the verses 6 through 8, even though it's part of our reading, to talk about the crown. That'll be another day, another time in which we may talk about that. But we're going to specifically talk about verses 1 through 5 and focus primarily only on that text and the charge given to Timothy. And as we do that, then the first thing to notice is this: the seriousness of the final charge from Paul to Timothy. The seriousness of the final charge. Note the tone, if you will, in verse 1. It means a degree of severity or solemnness or seriousness just within the expression of these words. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. That is directed to charge that's been given to Paul, I mean given to Timothy. He doesn't say yet what it is. We're going to get to that in just a moment. But notice the severity of the charge being given. It's being given in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. Now, as you see that phrase, here's what we need to know. Because I submit to you that it cannot possibly get more serious or more solemn that when you're given a directive that is given in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. It cannot possibly get ever more serious than when you're given a charge or directive in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. You know, we tend to think that there are somber, solemn, serious occasions in life, and truly there is. I don't know how many of you have ever seen the swearing in of an elected official. But we typically would view that as an oath that they take upon an elected office as something that would be very serious and somber and solemn. I mean, and it should be taken very seriously. Sheila and I have been watching on Netflix a show called Madam Secretary. I don't know if you've ever seen it or not, but we've been enjoying it the last couple of weeks. And we're into the second season. And into the second season, Elizabeth McCord is playing Secretary of State. And as we learn in the second season, suddenly, all of a sudden, the president is on Air Force One, and it disappears. I mean, it's like dropped out of space nowhere. And on the plane with the president is the Speaker of the House. Now, that's important because in the succession that you have for being president, if something should happen to the president of the United States, there is an order of succession for someone to carry on the active duties of the president. Naturally, the person to do so would be the vice president, if something should happen to our president. In the episode, it just so happens that the vice president is playing golf. As he's playing golf, he becomes extremely ill. As he becomes ill, the plane disappears. It goes to the third person, which would be the Speaker of the House, but he is on the plane with the president. In that event, it actually goes to the president pro tempore of the Senate. But he is called in to be able to take the office of the United States presidency, and it's viewed that he is incompetent. Maybe like a lot of senators are, right?
Right.
But they view his incompetency because they ask him who the president is, he thinks it's Ronald Reagan. And so they're viewing, hey, he's not competent to take the office of the president. So the next person in line is who? The Secretary of State, who in the show is Elizabeth McCord. So they call in Elizabeth, and the Chief Justice asks her to come in, and she's going to take the oath to become at least a temporary president of the United States. But here's the oath. Here's how it's done. A very serious, somber moment. She comes in and she lays her left hand on the Bible. He takes the Bible, she lays her left hand on it. And he asks her then to repeat after him, to repeat after me. And she has to say these words. I do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. She does all of that for left hand on the Bible. She says that, done, over, it's it. That's all there is to it. I mean, which one of us cannot do that? Any of us could do that if that's all it took to become President of the United States. But it seems like it's pretty serious and somber, and it should be. It's very similar, if you will, to another very serious oath that's taken. Is if you ever have had to go to court, you know that you always have someone who's going to come to you and ask you to be able to make sure that you give all the information, if you're appearing in court as a witness, completely accurate and true and honest. So a court reporter or a bailiff will come up to you, and again, they take the Bible, good that they're using the Bible, they ask you to place your left hand on the Bible, and they ask you to raise your right hand. And they say, do you swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? And of course you say, I do, or I will. Another serious, somber moment in which we should be taking things in that manner. That's it. That's all there is to it. And I use those illustrations and examples because we typically view those moments as something that should be seriously taken in that regard. But I go back to what's happening here now with Timothy and with Paul, because now Paul does with Timothy something that is more serious than anything we've ever been through in our life. He says to Timothy in the via of a letter form, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who, by the way, is to judge the living and the dead. I mean, again, it cannot get more serious. Certainly, that is the most serious time, moment, charge, directive, command given among men and women. But let's think about the phrase just a little bit further. Again, expression, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. and ask ourselves this question. Isn't everything that we do in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus? I mean, really, and when you begin to really think about it and dissect it and really, you know, think about our life, isn't everything that we really do in life in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus? And further than that, as the verse also adds, I mean, isn't he truly the judge of all the living and the dead? I mean, the answer, as we pondered that for just a moment further, is that yes, both is true. I mean, everything we do is visible to God somehow, some way in his presence. I mean, he's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. We can never get away from God wherever we go, whatever we're doing. So everything is done in somehow, some way in his presence. And yes, I mean, Christ Jesus is the judge. In fact, all of us who are believers, followers of Christ, who've given our life, our heart to him, will come in judgment at one time or another. All of us. Not just Timothy, but every one of us. So it's not just Timothy. The point is this. It's not just Timothy that will stand before him and give an account of a directive, of a charge being given. I mean, as much as everything is in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, and as much as that he is, yes, the ultimate judge, we are all very similarly given the charge, the directive, the command. We're all in a very somber, solemn moment given this task. What is the task? What is the charge? It's stated in three words at the beginning of verse 2. Preach the word. Preach the word. We're all commanded and charged to preach the word. I mean, I always view it greatly and extremely unfortunate that this fourth chapter begins with a split in the sentence. They take one sentence and they split it in two and they make a verse 1 and they make a verse 2. When you remove the chapter and the verse divisions, you get really the information that Paul wants to convey to Timothy. He says, Timothy, I charge you, yes, in the presence of God and in Christ Jesus, who is the judge of the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. He gives him the charge to preach the word. It's a continuation of a sentence, and unfortunately we have a verse dividing it, but remove it. And notice that the charge is to Timothy and to every one of us to preach the word, not exclusive just for Timothy. We need to understand it applies to every one of us. Not just meant for Timothy, not just meant for a preacher. I mean, it's interesting when you start to think about this direct and this command in this letter that Paul is writing to Timothy, that we have settled into a time of our lives in the church age in which we tend to believe that preach the word, convey the truth, is only really meant for a pastor or a preacher of a church. I mean, don't get me wrong, we are to be able to preach the word and convey the truth. I mean, it's certainly part of our responsibility. But God never meant for it to be limited or exclusive to just the pastor of a particular church. Now we can explain that by making a parallel. I mean, to preach the word really is similar, if you will, to making disciples. I mean, our Lord has said in Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, particularly beginning in verse 19, he's speaking to disciples, but applies to all of us, where he says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. I mean, in that particular text, at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus commanded disciples to go, spread the word, the good news, to make disciples throughout all the nations. But the command is not limited to just the disciples. I mean, I don't read many Francis Chan books. My son Tyler likes Francis Chan, listens to him quite often. I don't get a chance to listen to him or read a bunch of his material. But in his book called Multiply, he solidifies the point we're trying to make here. He says this, many read these words, the words we're dissecting today in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Many read these words as if they were meant to inspire pastors and missionaries on their way out to the mission field. But he says this with a question to make the point. But have you ever considered that maybe Jesus' command is meant for you? We sometimes don't think that. That it's meant maybe for somebody else. But here, Francis Chan, by using his words, brings us back to the conclusion we need to make that these words, this charge, this command is given to all of us, to all of God's children, to all believers, to keep the command, to preach the word. I mean, Chan is fully correct. As you begin to read through the New Testament, you see people working together in obedience to Jesus' commands. I mean, early Christians in particular reached out to people around them, calling them to obediently follow the Lord. And so this morning, we're just simply saying that we're called to do the same. Every one of us, everybody watching and listening and looking at me now, we're all called to do this. To make disciples, to preach the word. And by the way, now we're kind of adding emphasis that to what we're called to do by reminding all of us that one day we'll be like Timothy, that we'll all stand in front of God and give an account for our actions and words, whether we follow in the command. J. Vernon McGee, old pastor, preacher, reads this last part of Paul's letter and recognizes Paul is not talking to Timothy alone. He says, as we hear him, as we hear Paul, we will be hearing from God the things he wants us to hear. This is his final word, not only Paul is writing to Timothy, his final word to you and me. If you are not prepared to accept this, I don't think he has anything more to say to you. Now, when you hear what J. Vernon McGee is saying, that old country preacher J. Vernon McGee, you're thinking, wow, is it that serious? Where we don't follow this command to preach and teach the word, to convey truth to people? That God may not have anything else to say to us? Is it that serious? And it does have a great degree of seriousness to it. As the point we're trying to make here today is that all of us are to follow the command as given. And not necessarily in our leisure, and necessarily in the way we want it to be done, but as God has directed. As the words we read or hear from Timothy, or from Paul to Timothy. So just stop there for a moment and pause, reflect, and ask yourself this specifically then. What if this truly happened to you? Where God spoke to you personally, somehow, some way, he gave you a directive, a charge, and command. What if it personally happened to you somehow, some way? I mean, go back to the introduction. I mean, recall that at the beginning we asked, what do we do? What do we do when we are given a directive, a charge, a command? What do we do? Do we follow through? Do we whine and cry about it? Or do we do it as given? Do we obey or disobey a command in the word? And I think I overheard someone say, I mean, you would do it. I mean, when you know that God has given you a command and directive, and when you know for certain that God has led you to do a specific task, most of us say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, here I am. I will follow. I will obey. So if that's how you're thinking, if that's what you're saying you would do, or how are you doing with this command? Are you keeping the charge as Paul fully expected Timothy to keep this charge? And what I'm really saying is this, that these instructions that we've been reading, and specifically now to Timothy, are just as pertinent in our day as the day and the time they were written by Paul. And so somehow, some way, I mean, God is speaking to us at this particular moment, to you and to me right now. And what we see here then, very specifically, narrowly focused, is that he's telling all of us to preach the word. Now, to preach the word doesn't mean you get up in front and stand up a bunch of people like I am right now. I mean, you have an audience here, you may have an audience wherever you go, and it could be a church, you may have people gather around you, and you can say, I got to take my Bible and I got to preach like I see Curt do, or like I see others on TV. That's not really what we're saying you have to do. When we say you must preach the word, as Paul was telling Timothy here to preach the word, he means proclaim the truth. Lead people to understanding the good news and gospel of Jesus Christ. Because there's someone that you may be around that may not fully understand, or somehow, some way, may not have heard, which seems remarkable to think that some people somehow have not heard of Jesus. Years ago, when I was in Thailand, we were taking a moment to go to Chiang Mai University. We were talking to students there on campus. And in Thailand, you know, have international students here, even having the Oakland City College international students come in. You have them all over. In that particular area, we had girls, you know, women from China that was coming in. And we were on campus talking to people about the Lord, following the command to preach the word, convey the truth, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and began to speak to these Chinese girls about Christ, about Jesus. And they get this blank stare and look. Who? And you say, Jesus. And I said, we don't know no Jesus. It was remarkable to think that people in this modern day, with all the technology that we have never heard of Jesus. But they hadn't. So we conveyed the truth to them. And that's what we're commanded to do. I mean, somehow, some way, God has put you where you are for specific reason and purpose. And part of it simply is to preach the word, to teach, to convey the gospel, the good news. And you may be saying, but I'm not comfortable doing that. I don't know enough. I mean, I don't feel prepared. I don't feel qualified to preach and teach the word as you're telling me to need to. I mean, I see the directive, I see the charge. But I don't feel prepared or qualified or equipped. Well, let me tell you, there was once upon a time I didn't feel prepared or qualified, equipped. And at times I still may not feel fully equipped or qualified or prepared. Years ago, when I was first accepted Christ, lived in Mississippi, at the age of 38, I mean, it's almost 20 years ago, I was sitting into a Sunday school room in a large church in Clinton, Mississippi. A Sunday school teacher came in a little bit late. His name was Rob. Rob came in. Rob always covered the announcements, got into the scripture reading, did a little prayer. And that particular day, Rob was late for whatever reason. So as he come in, I was a plant manager, and I hate wasting time. So I grabbed the paperwork and I started looking at the notes, and I seen the announcements on the page, so I just took the liberty and the leisure to start making the announcements for him. He didn't ask me to, I just thought, hey, let's get this thing started. I don't like downtime. So I started reading the notes and the announcements. And he walked in and he sees me reading the announcements. He said, Curt, would you like to do the lesson today or read the scripture and have a word of prayer? I said, man, no. This is all I can do. Don't ever asked me to pray or to read scripture. I could never do that. And now look what I do today. So one of y'all may be the next preacher. You ready for that?
No.
Something to think about, though. What we're saying, though, is that God will equip you. If you just want to be obediently following the command, God will equip you. The Holy Spirit will give you words. The Holy Spirit will give you the utterance that you need if you're willing simply to obey. That's what we must do. Take the charge, the directive, the command, as written, as given. Don't manipulate it. Don't do it in your own way on timing. Just do it obediently. And the Spirit will give you what you need. He will equip you for the work and the task at hand. But notice if we go back to the text, the special circumstances to carry out the command. It's written in verse 2. To preach the word. To be ready in season and out of season. At least there are a third notation from the text that we are to live in a constant position of readiness. As we're commanded and ready to obey, we are to live in a constant position of readiness. Maybe the word to use, if you want to write it down, is to be diligent. Diligence. Diligent in season and out. So in other words, he means by having these words to be ready in season and constantly ready, we should be able to preach and teach the word at any time we are asked or an opportunity presents itself. I mean, listen, if you get a phone call at 2 o'clock in the morning, and someone calls you and say, Roger, I remember at work you said something about Jesus, but I don't remember exactly what it was. Can you elaborate? Can you expand? Or John, you sold a car, but you told me something about Jesus, and now I want you, as you sold the car, you said his word. What's it mean? I don't know why they call you at 2 o'clock in the morning, but they did. Okay? But you got to be ready. They may have woke up with something triggered in them. They couldn't go back to sleep, so they call you up and they ask you to elaborate and explain. You have to be ready. If they wake you up in a stupor, we're commanded to be ready, in season and out. To be ready at all times, even when you least expect it. I mean, 24/7, 365 days a year, to be ready, in season and out. As we use in season and out, in a different translation, the New Living Translation, words are slightly different, and it's kind of neat. It tells us to be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not. I mean, that every time that you're asked to give out a command and to follow, and to give somebody the good news, or you be exactly ready for the moment, you may not feel that you are, but you must be. Whether it's favorable at the moment or not, which means this, if you're at Walmart, you ever notice how Walmart now has certain aisles you can go down and certain aisles you're not supposed to go down? Something else that aggravates me, since we got back on that now, is that people that go down the wrong aisle. I don't get it. There is a red square right here that says, do not enter. And they'll push that stupid little buggy cart down in the way, and you're going down the opposite direction. Follow the notes. Follow the green arrow. Go down the right way. Or do you do that?
Yes.
You go down the wrong way, I'm going to talk to you later.
I back in.
You back in? Good.
Back
for you, Johnny. Good for you.
Good you for don't you. Go to Walmart.
Juanita will have special prayer after a while because she goes down the wrong direction.
Pay attention to them arrows.
That's what they're there for.
I don't care. I'm not going to walk out of my way.
But you got to be prepared. Even in that moment, when somebody like Juanita is going down the wrong way, Charlie does it too. Charlie, special prayer for you also. I mean, look, we're having a time of confession, aren't we? Special prayer for all of you. But you got to be ready, even in that moment, when somebody is coming down the wrong direction of the aisle, and all of a sudden they bump your cart, and they bump your cart, and you say, hey, look, what happened? They say, I don't know, can you have prayer? You got to be ready.
Yeah.
Because they really need prayer for going down the wrong aisle. Be ready in season and out, whether the time is favorable or not. I mean, one commentary added it this way for emphasis. We should be chomping at the bit, ready to give out the word of God in season, out of season. Means any time of the day or night, any time of the year, under any and all circumstances, even if going down the wrong direction on an aisle. 365, 24/7. Be ready in season and out. A constant state of readiness. It's a constant state of readiness that we must have. Obediently following the command to convey the truth and the gospel, good news to people. And if I'm going to just a final question, why? Why do we need to be ready? Other than just obediently following the command, why be prepared? Why be constantly ready to preach, teach, convey the truth? And it's simply because of verses 3 and 4. It's a matter of urgency. Look with me at verses 3 and 4. Because urgency is the utmost of importance. The time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. An urgency should exist in our communicating and telling people about the good news of Jesus Christ. As we hear verses 3 and 4 and ponder that, if you're like me, I begin to wonder if our contemporary society has already come to this place. Has society come to the point where Paul has been writing to Timothy about what will happen? Are we there? I mean, and a few weeks ago, we were contemplating this a little bit, talking about the end times, the last days, and we even referred to a church called Laodicea, which happens to be in Revelation chapter 3, the seventh of the seven churches. It's the church, if you remember, that has believers who are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold. And we were talking about lukewarm Christianity and Christians thinking, are we there? And so now we come back to that and ask ourselves, is that today? Is the church, Christianity in general, lukewarm today? And is the time when people, is it now, when they're turning away from sound doctrine and teaching? Is it happening? Are we there? Because I'm thinking, if we ain't there yet, if it's not the modern day, then we are very quickly approaching it. If we're not there, we're very quickly, each day that passes, minute by minute, quickly approaching a day where this is happening. Are people turning away from sound doctrine and truth? I mean, the truth really is this, that it's not hard. It's not hard to detect that some people come to church solely for business reasons, or solely to meet people, or to satisfy their parents or their grandparents. It's not hard to detect that. But even in that particular case, what we see from Paul's description here to Timothy is that it gets worse. It gets worse into some people just stop coming. And if they go anywhere, they're going to go somewhere, attend a service or a church that will satisfy their itch. What is their itch? Verse 3. Their own passions. Their own lusts. Eventually telling them fables and myths rather than to give them truth. Just simply to entertain the itch that they can receive from wherever they're going and be satisfied, thinking that whatever they're doing is justified. So they deviate from sound doctrine and teaching. And if we aren't there, if we are not there, then we are rapidly approaching that place in our times today. It's very troubling to see that in modern day. And we see Paul warning Timothy about it. And we see now, well, hey, we may be right there. Dr. David Jeremiah writes a book called Is This the End? And in that book he says this, morality in the United States is no longer in a free fall. It has hit rock bottom. This book was written, y'all, about 6 years ago. So it's advanced even from then. He says, civility in politics and tolerance of opposing ideas has disappeared. Corruption and dishonesty in government is rampant and open. Race relations are deteriorating. Earnings are declining. Civic disorder is accelerating. Ominous clouds are darkening our future. Many are asking, is this the end? Well, we don't really know positively the answer to the question, is this the end? But we do have enough capacity and ability and intelligence to see if this is not becoming the end, we're rapidly approaching it. And Paul seen that even in his day, that this time would come. And so he told Timothy this final directive, this final charge, four commands or four things to do to put into practice. He tells them, first of all, there is a charge, preach the word. And take the seriousness of it. Do as commanded. Just simply preach it and teach it. Don't have to change it. It's God's word. Just give it. To be constantly ready. And he tells us then that, yes, the time is urgent. It was urgent then, even more urgent today. So we bring the whole series to completion with a directive, a charge, given to all of us. Not just all of us as we are individual believers, because yes, we need to be able to do so. But as a church body together, Crossroad Baptist Church follows this command. We reach out to people continually, all the time, giving them the word. Every time we have an outing here at the church, every time we have an outreach, and people come in, whether it's for backpacks or clothes, a yard sale, Christmas toys, even a Thanksgiving dinner, we are ready and eager to give them the Word of God, the truth, and we should be. because people need to receive it. They may be coming to get something to satisfy them, but there's nothing that will satisfy them more than Jesus Christ. He will be the ultimate need they have, and it's our responsibility to give them, to feed that to them. Let's join together, and we do. Father, Lord, we thank you for the word today, Lord, the final command given to Timothy from Paul. We see how it now applies to us directly. And Lord, I want to thank you for a great church family that is fully understanding the command and goes about practicing it. So Lord, we again position ourselves to please you. We see it, we hear it, let us now obey it and follow. So Lord, today, if there be one here right now that has not fully accepted you into their life, I pray they would do so right now today, before it may be too late. We see signs of the end. We see things progressing. And Lord, I pray for everyone to see that, but also to act, to give the word, and for people to respond. Whether it be one here today for responding, or whether it be one that we know at home, our work, or school. So Lord, we ask that you penetrate the hearts of all the people we love. Thank you for the message. Thank you always for your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, I saw the light. The Lord is in us, I oh.